semester. We're going to focus today on material that's been covered since exam two that wasn't covered on exam two, since that's the only material that you have not yet been tested on. However, there is not a ton of material since then. We plan on using roughly an hour, maybe a little bit more, going over that. And then we are open to any questions about that material or any material from the entire semester. So please feel free to ask, and also feel free to stop us while we're going as well with any questions you have. So this is in no way meant to be an exhaustive list, but this is a list of some major topics that we've covered over the course of the semester that has already been on an exam one or exam two. So just resistors, inductors, capacitors, parallel and series combinations, and device laws. We have nodal analysis, which is always a correct way to solve a circuit. That will never not work. It just might not be the quickest or most efficient way of solving a circuit, but it is always trustworthy. We have superposition, supernodes, Thevenin, Norton. Those are all really useful tools for analyzing a complicated circuit. They only work if all of your devices are linear, so we're going to talk about nonlinear devices later and how we can go about linearizing them so that we can use tools like that. We have dependent sources. That was really useful, and that also helped us think about some of MOSFET models and such. Then we have op-amps and different configurations for them. So right, with an op-amp, to keep it stable, we like to apply negative feedback. And we had different sorts of configurations. So we had inverting and non-inverting amplifiers. We also made adders, subtractors. You can make integrators, differentiators, so those are really powerful. We also had like ideal op-amp assumptions, but then we also had some problems where we would like give you a specific model to use and you would plug that in. So lots of different stuff you can do with an op-amp. Then we had combinations of more complicated first order and second order systems. So we had RC circuits, RL circuits, and then the big one, RLC circuits, which lent itself to tons and tons of analysis. From there we branched off into like sinusoidal steady state. We had all of the different cases, you know, critically damped, underdamped, overdamped, and we saw all the different outputs for different inputs on that front. That led us into the impedance method, which then led us to transfer functions and filters and analyzing those filters and the quality of the filters and such. And then we also just kind of talked about comparators with positive feedback, and that allowed us to make oscillators and such, and those were also very useful in a variety of circuits. So that's just an incredibly brief overview of a lot of the first two-thirds of the semester. We're not really going to directly cover this today, but again, if anybody has any questions about any of that, please just, you know, mention it.
Yeah. And we can review any of these topics in depth after we do the new ones.
So in terms of what's been covered since the material covered on exam two, we had translational mechanics, right, modeling different physical domains in terms of circuits, mostly like mechanical. Then we had boost and buck converters. We talked about large signal versus small signal analysis with non-linear devices and linearizing non-linear devices. And we talked about diodes and MOSFETs in that context. We also talked about the MOSFET amplifier. And we also, over the course of the labs, we worked on our ultrasound board, which I think is a very good way, if you work back through a lot of those checkoff questions from lab 14, really understand the whole system, that can be a good way to review a lot of these different concepts, since a lot of these different building block circuits are in that system in some way or another. So to start off, I'm going to just talk about translational mechanics a little bit. So what's cool about translational mechanics is it's basically the idea that so many different things can be described in terms of differential equations, and that's what's really so powerful about using circuit analysis, because using circuits between resistors, inductors, and capacitors, nothing even crazier than that, you can draw a circuit that can then represent like any differential equation you can think of. And so any system that can be modeled by a differential equation, we can then represent as a circuit and then just use our standard circuit solving techniques in order to solve. So things, there are multiple ways to do this depending on how you want to translate between different domains. The model that we have been using this semester is called the mobility analogy. So in the mobility analogy, we have force corresponding to current, and we have velocity corresponding to voltage. I always remember it because V and V, so if you're ever confused, it's a good way to remember it. And then basically, if you look at all of your equations from circuit analysis with inductors, capacitors, and resistors, transistors versus mechanical, you know, similar equations, you're going to see that everything matches up nicely. So when we do this model like this, we're going to see that dampers correspond to resistors. And so if this has well, the damping constant, I think, if this is damping constant B, then this has resistance 1 over B, right? Masses correspond to capacitors, and the capacitance is just M. And lastly, springs, I never know the exact right symbol for a spring, it's like something inductory-ish, is an inductor, if it is spring constant K, inductance 1 over K, I believe. One thing that is always confusing for a lot of people, and it was very confusing for me when I took 002 and was first thinking about this, is like, you know, these have different units, right? So like, mass, like kilograms, is not the same units as like farads. So what this is really saying when we say that like the capacitance is M, it's kind of M. We're, you know, always going to need to give you some sort of conversion factor, which is like how many kilograms corresponds to a farad or something like that. We might not give it to you directly like that. It might more be something like, you know, 1 amp corresponds to 1 newton, and then 1 meter per second corresponds to 100 volts or whatever it is. But from those conversions just between the mechanical domain and the electrical domain, you should be able to derive all of the sort of unit conversions for all of your devices, basically using like the, you know, chemistry method where you just have all of your fractions and then all of the units cancel until you have what you want. So that's important to keep in mind. But like, given whatever the conversion rate between newtons and kilograms is, the numerical value on top of that for your capacitance is just M, your mass. So that's kind of how things work. Does that kind of make sense to everyone? All right, awesome. So now the question is, how do we actually sort of like take a full mechanical system and then convert it into a circuit? Because once we have it in a circuit with just resistors, inductors, and capacitors, we know how to solve that. That isn't really the point of interest here. The point of interest is really get it into a circuit, and then we know we can solve the circuit. So there's a nice set of rules that you can use that basically goes like this. So first, in your system, whatever it is, by the way, you should check lecture notes 18. This has the list of rules and has a lot of nice examples. I'm going to write up a simplified version up here, but please consult the lecture notes. So basically what you're going to want to do is, first step, in your mechanical system, identify every mass. And then turn it into a capacitor that's grounded. That's very key. So basically what that means is, in the physical system, presumably that mass is going to have some physical connections to other objects, whether they be, you know, sort of like that wall thing, just the straight line that we have in those systems, or, you know, dampers or springs, whatever it is. But basically, you're going to turn it into a capacitor. One side of the capacitor is grounded, and then all of the other connections are to the other side of the capacitor. And I'm going to do a few examples later, so we'll see that in action. But that's the general idea. The other side of the capacitor is then at just some specific node in the circuit. So you're just going to connect all other physical connections to the mass to that other side of the capacitor. Before I or whatever, but generally it's more likely going to be that you're applying a force to the system. Well, that's just going to correspond to a current source. You're going to add any sort of like independent sources like that, but from that point on, basically it's just a circuit that you can solve using your standard techniques. So a simple example. If you just have a mass with mass m, and then you apply some force to it, right? It's a very simple physical model, but you can imagine that circumstance. Well, using our rules, we take our mass, we turn it into a capacitor, and one side is grounded. And then because we're applying some sort of external force to it, that's gonna correspond to applying some external current to it, which is the same as just, an independent current source. So we're gonna get something that looks like this. I and the actual numerical value for I will correspond to the numerical value of this force combined with whatever conversion rate you have between newtons and amps. And then because this will also just implicitly be grounded, we can also just draw it like this, right? Very simple circuit. You know how to analyze this, but that's what this corresponds to from these rules. You can also get stuff that's more complicated. So what if we add a spring to this? So what if instead we still have our force on our mass, but then it's connected to a spring? And then there's this wall thing. So in this case, we're going to do the same thing. So our mass becomes a capacitor with one side grounded. And then, as we said, all other connections to it have to go to the other side. So that means that this spring, which turns into an inductor, is going to be connected to the capacitor up here. So we're going to have now an inductor over here. And then one way you can think about sort of like some sort of intuition beyond just blindly following rules that's sort of like a nice sanity check as you're going through this. The easiest one I find is that voltage corresponds to velocity. So that means that the voltage across any electrical component in your circuit corresponds to the velocity of that object in the mechanical domain. So like this wall is fixed, it's not going to move, and so it's kind of intuitive this would be at ground, 0 volts. So this is also just going to be over there. And then as before, we're applying a force which corresponds to a current source, and so we get something that looks like this. And again, usually we would draw this like this, and then all of the grounds are, you know, just one node. Yes.
So hypothetically, if the wall was like moving at a certain velocity, would that be like a voltage source over there?
Exactly. Yeah, so if I had some sort of representation here, I don't even know exactly what that would look like, but if we had some sort of it's a good question. If we had some sort of thing here that said, like, you know, it was just sort of like some positive velocity, right? Well, then that would essentially be like an applied velocity, which, as you said, would be an applied voltage source. So the rest of the analysis would still hold, but now we would have our inductor over here, and it wouldn't be grounded because it's not connected to ground. Now we would get like some sort of independent voltage source over here, which would be grounded, and this would be our circuit. All right, does that make sense? Any other questions about that?
And ultimately, all of these rules, they come from writing out the differential equations for your mechanical circuit and for your electrical circuit, and trying to find these kind of high-level principles that help you understand how to match one to the other. So these aren't just rules, they come from the differential equations. And they come from the differential equations where we've said that we want to make the analogy between force and current, voltage and velocity, and all of these parameters like so. And the reason we need to have this set of rules is that even though we could just generate any equation in either a mechanical or electrical analogy, we want to be able to make the analogy and be able to say things like you did in your lab, where you're like, okay, our mass increases, and since mass looks like capacitance, and we know how capacitance affects the resonant frequency, then we know how mass affects the resonant frequency. So you want to be able to draw the correct picture so that you can make those intuitive deductions.
Yeah, exactly. So one other example that I like, just because it gets more components in there, a full RLC, is that if we have now a bit of a more complicated system where we have now mass force pulling downwards on that, and this is an applied force, and then we have both, right, our damper, and then also a spring. They're both connected up here. Slightly more complicated, we've got a lot more components going on. So using our rules, it'll, you know, always get us the right answer. Our mass becomes a capacitor, one side is grounded. The connections to the mass are both this damper and this spring, and so each of those has to be connected to this top node of our capacitor. So, and they're both also connected then to ground in the assumption that this guy is not moving. So that means they're all just going to end up being in parallel, right? We'll have a resistor, and we'll have an inductor. And once again, because we have this force applied, we're also going to get this, you know, current source. So that's sort of how things work. One thing you might notice is that in all of the examples we've done thus far, everything ended up being in parallel. It is nice just to see at least one example of something where at least something is in series with something else, just to see how that might come about. So if we have a slightly more complicated physical setup, let me know if you can't read anything, but basically we have this mass, an applied force, we have a damper, and then on the other side we also have this spring mass damper system going on. So if we start with this mass, turn it into a capacitor, one side is grounded as always, and we'll put M1 here, and then all of the other connections to it have to be at this top node. So that means that this guy, which turns into a resistor, is going to be connected up there. And since this guy is ground because it's not moving, that'll be in parallel. V1 will be. But then this one, V2 also connects up there, but it's not grounded. So we'll see what happens. But we get a resistor. And then we also have this mass. So this mass, we are also going to draw a capacitor, and it's going to be grounded. So, and it's clearly on, the way it works is like you ground one side and then all of the other connections connect to the other side. So if we're already connecting it on one side to this resistor, then the other side is the one that has to be grounded. So we're gonna get something that looks like this. Right, we have our capacitor, one side's grounded, the other side is the one that connects to our resistor, but then it's also connected to this spring, so this side also connects to the corresponding inductor, which on the other side is then also grounded because of this connection. So this is the circuit we get from this. And of course we always have our, for simplicity, let's just get rid of this for a second, no independent source. If we were to have an independent source, then once again, we would just have our independent current source over here in parallel with everything. But we see that for this setup, even can get series combinations out of this too in the electrical circuit you draw. But that's kind of how translational mechanics works. We have problems where you sort of had to do some of that numerical conversion, which we talked about earlier. And then beyond that, you should now be more or less comfortable with just taking a mechanical system and then drawing a circuit from it. And then you can solve that circuit however you'd like.
And so with this in mind, maybe go back to that lab and see if you can kind of intuit yourself why they drew the model the way they should.
Does anybody have any questions on that? Or yes?
So why did you decide to orient the current source upwards in all the examples? Because sometimes it's going towards the mass and sometimes it's going away from the mass.
It's a good question. I mean, one thing to note is just that, right, like if you make the current source negative versus positive, then the direction is going to flip.
Mm-hmm.
So that will also then be tied into sort of how you numerically then convert between different things. You know what I mean? In terms of like the preferred direction, I don't know if there's like a perfect way to, I'm sure there is, I don't really have like a quick rule for exactly how to think about that. One thing you can sort of think about is that, think about this, it kind of ends up having to do with sort of the directionality that you define, which is always kind of the case with voltage. I realize this is current. But, right, in terms of the positions end up being sort of like your nodes, because at the end of the day, like, this mass is going to be moving with some velocity, and that sort of then corresponds to the voltage. So oftentimes when we have these physical systems, you'll see something like this, where it'll have like a little bar, and it'll say X right here. So that's sort of the directionality, and that's what you're sort of watching move. So when you define those sort of directionalities, if you were then to actually write out the full differential equation of the mechanical system, you would get something from this exact setup of the form F equals, like, you know, M dx dt or whatever, and so on and so forth. And then if you just map that, you know, to an electrical system, you'd see that it's just like, F, the total force is distributed among all of these terms. Similarly, this total current I is distributed among all of these terms. So that's sort of like how it actually is derived from the bottom up. In terms of like a quick way to just know exactly how to do that, I'll have to get back to you. I don't have a perfect rule. Any other questions? Yeah, so I think the way to kind of think about that is just whenever you have a mass, it's going to correspond to a capacitor that has to be grounded. So like one thing you could wonder is like, well, what if I were to ground the other side of the mass? And it's kind of easy to think about like which side of the mass are you grounding. That isn't the right way to think about it, only because like the mass, like, is like a stiff object, right? It's not going to stretch or compress or anything like that. So what you're basically doing is you're taking this mass, you're turning it into a capacitor. One side is always going to be grounded, and then the other side, whatever that node is then going to connect all of the other physical connections to that mass. So we drew M2 as a capacitor. It's grounded on this side, and then this node connects to all other physical connections to that mass, which is both the, you know, damper, which corresponds to our resistor, and this spring, which corresponds to an inductor. The surrounding pieces of the circuitry followed from there. But all of your masses are going to be grounded capacitors, if that kind of answers your question. Anybody else? This is not, like, this is a confusing topic. Like, you know, I struggled with it when I took double, you know, it's a hard one. But that ends up having to do with like the underbelly of how you actually turn your mechanical system into an electrical system. So if you were to actually like take one of these more complicated circuits and do out all of the device laws for like, you know, your physical systems and get all of your force equations, you know, like a free body diagram, it kind of pops out of the math.
one way you could probably think about it is we know that velocity is like voltage, so at basically every node we're talking about some sort of velocity, and since a mass has like one velocity, it kind of makes sense, and if we think of basing the other velocities in the system on the mass, it kind of makes sense to say, okay, let's set some zero velocity reference point, so you know every mass gets a zero velocity reference point, i.e. ground on one side, and then we think about the actual velocity of that mass based on the node voltage or node velocity at the other point.
Yeah, I mean, one other thing that comes out of that is that, right, one distinction between the way we generally think about circuits versus physical systems is like, in a circuit, right, there's no such thing as like an absolute voltage, it's always a differential reading, right? So in these circuits, when we just sort of like define a ground point and just declare that that's at 0 volts or whatever, and then everything is referenced to that, any device you look at with some voltage drop across it will correspond to an object with that velocity in your physical domain, but sort of what we decide to call our 0 voltage point doesn't really matter because all of our voltage readings that correspond to velocities are differential. Anyone else? Alrighty.
Next topic. So the next thing that we're gonna go over is boost and buck converters. So boost and buck converters, you can devote entire classes to this, which classes like 6131 do devote entire semesters to, but we're kind of going to just cover the basics of them. Basically, the two things you want to answer as an electrical engineer are sometimes you have one voltage and, you know, you're powering something from your laptop and you need a higher voltage or you need a lower voltage, or in your lab you had the 5 volts from the USB, and you wanted 30 volts for your ultrasound system. So boost and buck are the ways that we solve these problems. So the first one we'll look at is a buck converter. And what a buck does is it takes a high voltage and it steps it down to a low voltage. So And the other thing about boost and buck is they do this in a power efficient way. So power is conserved in this system. The power at the input is equal to the power at the output, assuming that your components are ideal. You know, your capacitors and inductors aren't lossy. So we've actually seen some ways to go from high voltages to low voltages already in this class. And you know, if in lab you're asked to build this on the spot, the first thing you might think of might be, okay, we have a voltage source, and we take two resistors, and we create a voltage divider. So this would be one way to do this. The problem is that this isn't very power efficient. Why? Well, as soon as we connect our system to the output, we're going to be drawing lots of current through these resistors, and they're going to be dissipating. So a kind of intuitive example for what this means would be like if you're, you know, sitting in like a toy car and you want to slow down, so you're going from a high velocity to a low velocity, this would be like, you know, taking your feet and rubbing them against the ground and trying to use friction to slow you down. So that's kind of what these resistors are doing. They're like kind of like friction, going back to our mechanical analogy. And so this isn't great. What's the other thing you could do? Well, if you had the on button, you could just kind of pulse the on button. And that would also change your velocity. So you'd go really fast for a bit, and then you'd coast, and then you'd go fast, and then you'd coast. And this is maybe, if some of you drive, this is maybe how you drive. I don't drive, but I imagine it's like that. Okay, so what do we do? Well, we remember that, so the pulsing mechanism is what's known as PWM, so pulse width modulation. And the idea is that you take on for some period of time, and then you go off for some period of time. And then you go on, we can compute what that value is. This would just be taking a weighted average. So we know that we'll define something called the duty cycle. So whenever you talk about PWM, you'll talk about two things. There will be the duty cycle, which defines the ratio of the time you're on to the time, the total time. And then you define the frequency. So how fast, like how fast does each period occur? So we're gonna focus on duty cycle. So duty cycle, D is defined as time on to total time. So if we were to put this in here, we would say that we're looking at a time on of D, a time off of 1 minus D. Good so far? Okay, so then our average,
Just one quick thing to note is that, I think Hannah just said this, but just to be very clear, D is not actually the length of time, and 1 minus D is not actually the length of time. That is the fraction.
Yeah.
So, like, if little t here is now the actual period of this whole thing, then that is the duration of time. Like, D is a fraction. D might be 75%, so 1 minus D is 25%, depending on what fraction of the time it's on versus off.
So if we were going to say we were talking about two things, then we would have the duty cycle and the frequency, 1 over the period, and the total time here would be dt plus 1 minus dt, which is just t. So this would be, that would define that. Thank you. Let's see. Okay, so then what do we have here? We would have that V out on average, I'm going to just use these brackets to write average, but that's all it means. Would be what the weighted average, so how long are we on? So we're on for a fraction of time, dt over 1 minus, dt over t. So could write dt over t, and it makes sense that t's cancel out. And the voltage we get at that point is v in. So weighted average, expected value, these are all kind of the same thing. And then plus the time we're off. So we have a fraction of time, 1 minus d, t over t, times, and the value when we're off is just 0. So we get that the average output voltage is just D times V in. So, okay, so this is better. At least we're not dissipating as much power. The problem here is, what if you have a device that actually needs, like, a constant voltage? There's some things that, like, maybe you don't actually want it to just do this kind of jerky motion. So what do we do? You actually know how to solve this problem. Well, we know that a square wave is made up of sinusoid waves. So we know this is equal to, it has some DC component. The DC component is the average component, and we just computed that average component here. So it's equal to D times V in, and then we have a bunch of sine waves, so we have like this sine wave, and they go higher frequency. So, you know, from 1803, you would know that if the frequency here is f, then the frequency content of these waves is, let's see, f, 3f, 5f, etc. And the amplitudes of these are decreasing, but we don't really care about that for now. And you've done, so the goal is to get some sort of stable D times V in value and to get rid of all these sinusoidal components. And you've done this now a million times in lab. You add a filter. So in particular, you add a low-pass filter, which will remove these components. Low-pass filter. And then you're going to want to set the cutoff frequency of your low-pass filter to be lower than the frequency of your sine waves so that they are removed. And when you do this, you'll end up with a very power-efficient system that has an average voltage of dV in, probably some amount of ripple in that voltage because you didn't, you know that filters aren't perfect, so they're not going to entirely cut off all of these frequencies, but they do a pretty good job. So if we go and add this onto our system, doing the thing with the switches, so we turn them on and off. So we'll have one switch here. Another switch here. So this would do PWM. And if we add a filter, so what kind of filters are low pass? Well, we know that if you add a capacitor, at low frequencies, and this is ground, at low frequencies, a capacitor isn't open, and at high frequencies, a capacitor is short. So if we add a capacitor like this, it will allow the DC component and will block the high frequency components. And we'll key is the capacitor, though, so, so we add our inductor, our capacitor, and then the key thing when you're looking at a buck is that the resistor drawn here is actually your load, so I'll write RL for the load, but really this is the output. But really, so this load is not part of the circuit that you design. When you design your buck, you design it for a particular load because you know that that's going to change your cutoff frequency slightly. And the key part is really that you have this switching that gives you dBin, so this dBin tracks the whole way. And then we know that adding the capacitor and inductor are going to do our filtering for us. So this is basically PWM plus filter gives you a lower voltage. Any questions on this?
Is, what is the point of exactly, like, why you have an inductor before the capacitor or resistor?
Yeah, so, let's see. We basically want to keep a constant current, and we'll see this in the boost in particular. But if we want to maintain current going to our load, inductors are really good at that because they don't like change. So basically, the inductor just keeps the current moving in the circuit. So you could imagine when this switch is closed and this switch is open, we're basically just sending the current through. And when the other way, when we open this switch and close this switch, we're basically charging up. So, it's basically for current. Okay. So the next thing is, let's see. So the next thing is a boost converter. And a boost takes a low voltage and generates a high voltage. And one thing to keep in mind with both of these systems is these are not like infinite power generating systems or anything like that. Power in is power out. So if you go from a low voltage to a high voltage, then you're going to go from a higher current to a lower current and vice versa. So something to be mindful of. So what are we doing here? Well, we'll start with our voltage source again. And in this case, we're going to go back to thinking about inductors. So we want to maintain some sort of current. And we know that the cool thing about inductors there's two cool things. One is that they don't like to have changes in their currents. So if any type of change we make in the system, the inductor is going to maintain the same current it had before. And the other thing about inductors is that they can kind of, so just as capacitors charge in that literal, they build up a store of charge, inductors can charge up in that they build up a store of current. And that's the principle we're going to use. So the intuition for a boost converter is that we're going to charge up an inductor, and then we're going to send this current from the inductor shooting off into our load to get as high a voltage as we can. So what this will look like is we'll have an inductor that's ready to be charged. And now, well, how would we charge it? So if we start by having our voltage in and a switch here, if we close this switch, we'll build up a potential difference over the inductor, V in and zero. And we know that V is L di dt. So we'll increase current linearly over time for as long as this switch is closed. So I'll call this switch one. And then what do we do? Well, then we'll have another switch, and this will be the other part of our system. So this will be capacitor, and then ultimately our load. Okay, I think this is correct. Seems correct. Okay. So what is going on in this case? Some analysis. So the first part would be when we close switch one, we'll have switch one will be on for a time for dt. And we know that at that point, if this isn't open, this part of the circuit is kind of meaningless. So we're going to be charging up our inductor, and this is the important first stage. So we know that the current we're going to end up with is going to be 1 over L V in dt. Capital dt. Okay, and then what's the second phase? So if we're going to close this switch, open this switch and close this one, then we're going to have the second stage where the current is now shooting off into the rest of our system. And again, the capacitor acts like a filter, which is what we like. So then we'll say that V out, so we note that V out over our load is the same as V out over our capacitor. And because of the capacitor and its filtering and kind of smoothing things out, we'll just assume that V out is essentially stationary over this period of time. So again, we'll have delta I is equal to 1 over L, and what was the change in voltage? So it went, so the voltage across the inductor now is V in minus V out. So that was our voltage, and what was our time? The time that we spend in this phase is 1 minus dt, t minus dt. Okay. So then we know that if we're operating in a steady state where we're not building up an output charge infinitely and our output charge is not decaying away to zero, and there's a more in-depth analysis of these two cases in the notes, come talk to me if you're interested in going through that. But basically we know that steady state for I would look like we start at some value, we charge up for a time dt, and then it's going to return to its original value. So this is 1 minus dt, So that's gonna be 1 over L, I'll pull out the T, V out minus V in times 1 minus D. T's cancel out, L's cancel out, and what are we left with? Hopefully something good. V in. Previous case we had V out is equal to D times V in, and since D is the duty cycle, it's a fraction, it's going to be less than 1. So if D is a fraction less than 1, the denominator is going to be something less than 1, and ultimately V in over that thing less than 1 is going to be greater than 1. So this is going to be greater than V in. So this is a boost converter. Any questions about this? Yeah, so in reality, the switches are like a means to doing this analysis, but you're exactly right. Like when you were doing this in lab, you actually ended up using a diode for S2. So why would you do that? Well, if you bring this back. So if we had a diode for S2, so current only flows in one direction. If we have that this switch is closed, then what we wanted with our switches was if this switch is closed, that the other switch is open. So imagine this switch is closed. Well, this is a constant potential line. So this voltage is going to be 0. And the output, the capacitor is always storing some sort of positive charge. So the voltage across the diode will be negative side to positive side. So it will be off. So we'll often use diodes for the high side switch. We'll often use MOSFETs for the low side switch because just the way MOSFETs work, they're easier to control. And these are just kind of a lot of the little details. And you've seen some other ways you could do this. So in lab, you were using a device that had feedback to actually help you with the gains that you got. So there's a lot of ways to go about building boosts and bucks. And then as I said, there are entire classes devoted to just this topic, but the kind of the building block of it are these two kind of fundamental forms.
So for that expression to hold true, it has to be that the change in current is like the same going on.
Yeah, in steady state. And that's how you're gonna want your boost to operate. Like you wouldn't want the output voltage to be increasing infinitely over time, which probably wouldn't, or you know, likewise decreasing to 0.
Any other questions?
Okay. Let's see. So, small signal analysis.
By the way, to answer the earlier question about the direction of like the current source and the transition at the intersection, so the thing is with resistors, capacitors, and inductors, right? With all the device laws, if you like negate voltage, it also negates current. Right? So it really does have to do with that directionality. And generally, one way that you can sort of be confident that it's going to work is that when you actually draw that diagram, it will be useful for you, as I mentioned before, to actually sort of like define the direction of, you know, the position that you're measuring in. So like if a mass moves up versus down, that being positive versus negative in some directionality. So if you define all of the positive directions as like with the applied force, then it'll look like what we're used to, which is that the current is coming out of ground and then down through the components back to ground. If we were to define the directionality of the motion of the objects in the other direction, then we would just draw all of, I mean, basically what that would do which you could then imagine, which is basically just like switching the polarity of all of the voltages, which you can kind of also think about it if we have a simple circuit where we have like a top line and a bottom line and all everything in between them. That's the same as like just flipping which one's called ground and which one isn't, you know what I mean? That kind of makes sense. It's all about the directionality is the point. But if everything seems to be pointing in the same direction, the motion of the objects, the positive direction of motion, and the applied force, they're all pointing in the same direction, then you'll get that nice form where like the current source is from ground pointing up. So for large signal versus small signal analysis, the idea is that sometimes we will have devices that do not have a linear voltage current relationship, and those are very ugly to work with. So one example that just came up is the diode. So diodes are very useful. We have different models for them, which are useful in different contexts, but the actual voltage current relationship for a diode something like this, where if we have voltage and current, it's going to look something like that. So that's not exactly the easiest to use if this were in some other circuit, because as soon as a diode is just one example, but if you have any non-linear device, then all of a sudden your circuit's no longer linear. So we can't use superposition, we can't use Thevenin, we can't use Norton. All of that stuff, we always said, only applies if it's a linear circuit, and for a long time everything we did was linear, so it didn't really seem to matter. Well, now it does matter. Nodal analysis does always work, but that's probably not going to be your best bet in solving these circuits. So what we like to do is we like to try to find a way of actually linearizing this so that we can analyze it as if it were a linear circuit. So generally the idea we use behind that is that hopefully your input signal, if we're working with an input voltage source, then hopefully if the voltage that ends up dropping across the diode at any given time is always going to fall like in this small region, that means that we're only really concerned with that region of the diode's IV curve. And like, even though it's not, that looks close enough to a straight line, right? Like if we draw the tangent line here, it's a pretty close approximation in this small window. So the idea is we're gonna want to linearize it as if it were kind of like a resistor. But there's a lot of sort of overhead to make sure we do that correctly. So as an example, just to see when this would be relevant, by the way, in case you're interested, it's actually an exponential relationship. The relationship here is ID equals some constant IS e to the V over KT over Q. KT over Q is just constants, and then minus 1. So that's the actual relationship here, and that will become relevant if you do the full mathematical derivation for the example we're about to do. But say that we had a circuit with a diode in it. So imagine that we had this circuit, where we have Vn, we have our resistor R, and then we have our diode. So you could, as I said before, solve this from like first principles, right? Like we have that expression for the relationship between the current through the diode and then the voltage across the diode, and you know, from KVL and KCL, we can basically solve this circuit directly, but it's going to be very, very ugly if we do it that way. What we like to do instead is this. Just from looking at the rest of the circuit, excluding the diode, we know that first of all, there's just one current going around and around, and whatever voltage that the resistor doesn't drop, the diode has to drop the rest to add up to Vn. So we know that like Vn So we can actually like plot this line, which is just a linear expression, on this curve. So this is also ID versus VD. So this says VD is equal to VN minus RI. So if we were to draw that on here, we get some sort of just straight line that looks like that. And then wherever, we also know that this relation still holds between VD and ID. We now have two expressions. We have two equations that relate VD and ID to one another. So we plot both of them, this like graphical analysis, and then wherever they intersect, that is called our operating point or our bias point. You know, this is basically the large signal analysis. Wherever they intersect is going to be the solution for VD and ID. Right, and that kind of makes sense. We have two constraints on what it's going to be from the applicable diode itself and then from the circuit we've placed it in. So wherever those two constraints meet each other, that's the answer we get. Does that make sense?
And if you've plugged in this exponential formula, you would be just literally solving for this point. But instead, it's often easier to do it graphically.
Could you explain the KT over Q and the time constant for the exponential?
So that's like just the way a diode works. I'm sure there is a good explanation for it. I don't really have one for you, but this is just like the voltage current relationship for a diode.
Transistor physics, so.
Any other questions before we move on to the actual linearization? Yeah.
We would always be given KT over Q, right?
Yeah, I mean, you shouldn't need to know that.
Yeah. So I guess something that could happen is, you know, maybe they tell you where this point is and then they ask you to find KT over Q, but if you ever needed to know it, there would be some way from the problem to find it. So it's not like a thing you need to measure to find yourself. Like types of questions they could ask would be like, you know, so like T is temperature. So if you know, you change the temperature of where your circuit is, you know, what happens to the voltages and currents? That could be something they ask. But yeah, you won't have to know the value.
Yeah, one other thing just to note is that K and Q are just like physical constants, those never change, and then T is just the temperature, like in Kelvin. So that doesn't answer your question directly, but like that is at least reassuring. These aren't just like floating random things. I'm pretty sure also that like KT over Q at room temperature is like 26 millivolts. You should check me on that. But in case that's just, you know, reassuring to have some sort of value in your mind. But like, don't worry about that. Yeah.
So your x-intercept for your line would be Vn, and then
I'm sorry?
your x-intercept for the line would be Vn, and then the y-intercept would be Vn over r.
Yes. Yep. Anyone else?
Yeah, so that's another thing is like whenever I would do this, if I ever decide that graphical analysis is the right way to solve the problem, when I do this, I'll always like label what are these points, because then if they go, you know, just as they could ask you what happens when temperature changes, they could ask you what happens when R changes, or like what do you need to do with R in order to get, you know, the currents and voltages to change or something like that. So it's always helpful, like if you know what these points are, definitely label them. Label anything that you know.
So, the question is this. This works perfectly if Vn is a constant, right? That gives us everything we need to know. But oftentimes we'll be working with an input signal that isn't exactly constant, and the question is, what do we do then? So the hope, as I mentioned earlier, is that Vn will be centered around some constant value, and then it'll sort of like ripple on top of that a little bit. So if Vn were literally like ranging from like 0 volts to like, you know, 20 volts or something, this method that we're about to do is not going to work. But the hope is that if Vn is like rippling just in that little window right here, well, if we were to draw all of the, you know, graphical analysis lines that correspond to all of these points, we would get, you know, something slopes of these lines aren't changing because the resistance R isn't changing, but like we get these different load lines. But as we mentioned before now, this just defines a certain window within our diode IV curve. And the idea is that in a sufficiently small window of that curve, we can roughly approximate it as a linear relationship. And basically, if you do it mathematically, you're basically going to be taking like a Taylor series of this IV curve, and then basically saying that everything above the linear term is too small, so we kind of like ignore it, if that makes sense. So the idea is that first, every time you're going to do some sort of analysis like this, you have to find the, the original bias point itself. So that works exactly as we just did it, where you have whatever Vn is, and then you just do this graphical analysis and you get this point. Vn, in that case, you have to use a constant voltage, and that will be whatever your like large signal is. That will, you know, presumably be given to you. And that then defines your bias point. But then the idea is, if this were a linear relationship within this small window, well, a linear relationship that's like a resistor. So the goal is that in the large signal, we would do this, but then in the small signal, we would love to get something like this. So now everything is small. It's very helpful and very clarifying when you're taking the exam to differentiate between your large signal and your small signal. So just as a quick side note, generally our convention for that is this, the total signal we use lowercase letter, but then uppercase subscript, so like little v, capital N, it could also be little I, capital N. And then for the large signal component, they're both capital, so that would be capital V, capital N. And then for the small signal, they're both lowercase. Messy, but that's kind of the idea. And the total signal is just equal to the large signal plus the small signal. But just be clear when you write V in or I in or whatever it is, or V out or I out, just whether you're talking about the total thing, the large signal, or the small signal. And if you're worried, you know, because the letter V is kind of like the same lowercase and uppercase or whatever, just be very clear. You can even like just draw an arrow to it and say small signal or something like that, you know, whatever you want to do, but just be very clear. Both for us grading it, but also for yourself, so that you don't start mixing things up.
Definitely, like, before the exam, develop your own system and, like, write it out a couple times and make sure, like, you won't confuse your V's and
right.
That sort of thing.
It might feel weird, but, like, one thing you can do that's easy is just, like, capital V's have the little, you know, serifs or whatever, and then the lowercase V's don't. So even if they're not next to each other and you can't see the exact size comparison, you know from that. Whatever you want to do. Alright, so the goal is that in the small signal, that we would get something like this. We still have our resistor R, now we're just looking at the small signal component of our Vn. And the hope is that we can replace our diode with a resistor in the small signal model. So if we were always, you know, measuring V out, either way, if we're measuring V out across the diode, then in this small signal model, we would get a small signal V out across this, you know, resistor, since that's the model for the diode. And essentially, from the graphical analysis, the value of RD is just going to be like 1 over the slope of that line. And that makes sense, right? Because if this were actually a resistor, this line would have slope precisely 1 over RD. So the way you're going to end up doing that in order to find that value, you're basically going to differentiate this expression and then get from there. So usually, right, for a resistance, it's V over I, but now we want I over V. So what you're going to end up doing, is you basically want to differentiate your IV characteristic expression, and then evaluate it at your bias point. we were to differentiate this with respect to VD, you know, DI, D, DBB is just, you know, the minus one piece, that's just the constant, so that goes away. And then for the VD piece, the exponential, we get, you know, like IS over KT over Q times E to the VD over KT over Q. And then we're going to want to evaluate at bias point VD, right? Because this expression, whatever you plug in for VD, is going to be the derivative of this slope wherever you are along it. So we find this general expression for the derivative of that line, of that curve. You evaluate it at the actual bias point that you're operating at, and that comes from your large signal analysis. And then because this is DID over VD instead of the other way around, this turns out to be 1 over R small signal resistance. So like this guy is going to be 1 over this expression. Does that make sense to everyone?
Does it make sense why we're doing the, like, why we're taking the derivative and, like, what this math is? Okay.
And I do strongly recommend, I'm not going to go through the entire mathematical derivation here, but in lecture 23, the notes for that, they really go through all of the math, and they start from, like, a full Taylor expansion and show all of the different terms that come out and then show which terms we're dropping because they're small. And then we basically get exactly the same thing as this. Yes.
Would it ever be appropriate for a second order in any situation?
So the whole idea, so it's a very good question because it's possible that could be relevant. And the thing is, the whole idea behind this is like, this is going to be inexact. We're going in fully aware of the fact this is inexact. But the entire idea behind doing this is because we have so many good tools for analyzing linear circuits. We want to shove this into being a linear circuit any way we can. So while adding more and more terms will make our analysis more and more accurate, it kind of loses the idea behind why we're doing it in the first place if we don't end up with something linear.
Would we want to numerically simulate it? Do you have to go to second order for whatever reason?
Yeah, I mean, like, if you did need to analyze a circuit that you couldn't properly linearize, then you might need, like, some sort of numerical method. Yeah, I mean, like, one thing is we're working with something that has a fairly nice IV curve, even though it isn't linear. If we had a device, right, we could make up some nonlinear device that has any IV curve we want. So if we have some nonlinear device whose IV curve looks... Sorry, can't go back on itself. If it, you know, looks like that, which, like, it could, why not? Then, like, if we're somewhere in this region, it might be a reasonable idea to linearize it since that's kind of straight. If our operating point is right here, we will not get something particularly accurate if we linearize it because, like, it is changing very quickly right here. I mean, our resistance would, you know, that would be our tangent line, and then it would be nothing like the actual circuit. So there are certain cases where your best bet would just be to kind of... try to solve it directly or numerical methods for it. But for this, generally, the goal is that we are going to linearize some section of a curve that seems reasonable to linearize. Does that make sense?
The one thing that, like, the second order and higher approximations do give you, even if we are, so this is just, I've written out the Taylor expansion and kind of, you know, this is your total signal, your bias, and if we subtracted the bias from the total signal, then it would be equal to or 1 over R times our other small signal input. The thing that this second order and higher terms give you is kind of an approximation or an understanding of where this approximation might be good. So if it turns out that you compute the second order term and that that's bigger than your first order term, well then your approximation isn't very good. So something, it's not impossible that they would ask something like that, but if they wanted to ask, where is your approximation good, then you would be looking at where does the second order term start to become small relative to Cuz the idea is that if this approximation is good, then these terms are kind of disappear. So comparing these two terms is something that is relevant.
In terms of the example we were doing, if from your graphical analysis, if this point we say is, you know, let's see this way. Capital B, capital B, capital I, capital B, and that's our bias point, then if we were to try to solve like V out in terms of V in, our total solution would be the combination of our large signal analysis from the graphical analysis and then our small signal analysis. So this small signal analysis is very easy. This is just a voltage divider, right? From this we get that V out is just V in times RD over R plus RD, right? So then if we were to combine all of our stuff together and we wanted the total solution, we would get that like V out was equal to our bias point VB, and that would have come from our total analysis from before, which is obviously dependent on the large signal input VN. But we would get VB, and then plus for the small signal component, little v little n times RD over R plus RD. Because this is the large signal of the output, and this is the small signal of the output. So that would be how you would get like a total solution in a problem like this. Does that make sense? Any questions about this? Yeah.
So how does adding DC offset affect, so does adding DC offset affect where your operating point is, or does it more so affect the curve itself?
When you say adding a DC offset, where are you going to add it to? You mean like, you know, VN, like changing the value of VN?
Or like adding it after, like between the resistor and the diode.
Oh, I see. Yeah, I mean, if we're just changing the value of VN, then basically that would just slide you along this line, right? As we said before, this slope is just defined by R. So this slope is always going to stay the same, but you can sort of imagine just like sliding a bar across the graph and just like locking it in whenever it hits VN on the x-axis. So yes, adding a DC voltage or taking off a DC voltage, whatever, will define where your bias point is along this curve. If we were to add another voltage source here, I haven't really thought about that, but I think it would basically be equivalent if we just combined it with the first one. Like I don't think it matters splitting it up before or after the resistor.
So what are you doing with this water already on the top?
Yeah, so the idea is that in this small signal model, we ultimately want to turn our diode into a resistor, because
yeah,
that's linear. So
what do you mean by linear?
This, as in, this expression is the general expression for the derivative of this curve, right? We differentiated ID with respect to VB. So this expression has a VB in it. It's a variable expression.
Yeah.
So whatever value of VB we plug into it, it'll be the derivative of this line at that VB value. We want to, you know, basically plug in our bias point VB such that we get the derivative of this curve at our bias point. Once we plug in capital V, capital D to this, and we get just a number, that is equal to 1 over RD. I didn't want to say equals 1 over RD because this is still a variable expression. If we were to evaluate this at capital V, capital D, then that number equals 1 over RD. And the reason it's 1 over is just because we're doing I over V. We had an expression in the opposite direction, it would just equal RD.
And one of the best parts of small signal analysis that this whole time we've been saying, every time we say, you know, superposition and Thevenin and Norton, we always tell you, oh, you can't do that for nonlinear devices, because all of those things rely on an IV curve that is linear and passes through the origin. The thing that small signal analysis gives you is that from every, if you think about some, you know, some signal like here that has some DC component and then some little wiggle, you can subtract this signal. can subtract the DC, the bias point, from everything in the circuit. So you will end up with your circuit, one circuit that's the bias points, another circuit that is completely linearized. So if you linearize every element in your circuit, then you can apply all those tools that you did for your normal linear analysis. So superposition, you know, is back in the game, that sort of thing.
Right, and related to what Hannah said, it's an interesting point, because one thing that might occur to you is that if we look at this line that I've started to draw tangent to this curve, it doesn't go through the origin. And any actual resistor's IV curve always goes through the origin. So it feels kind of odd that we're then saying, like, oh, so the small signal analysis is just a resistor rather than like a resistor plus this offset term. But the idea is kind of what Hannah said, that like the bias point basically gets us here, and then our small signal model is just analyzing it sort of like within the world of this region.
It's like we move the origin.
Right. Because of our bias point.
Yeah, so make sure whenever you see a line, just because it's a line doesn't mean your device is linear. So a diode is a great example when they draw the diode, like if they ever give you a diode that looks like this, you know, where this is like your threshold voltage and then it turns on. This is a line, but this is not a linear device because at I is not equal to, you know, V times some R when V and I are zero. That's not true for here. So it always has to go through the origin to be actually linear. So it's a tricky concept. But yeah, the analogy that Jacob used where you kind of shift into the frame of reference of your bias point and think about that as your new origin is really helpful.
Just for the small signal analysis piece of it. Are there any other questions about that, or shall we move on? All right.
Okay. MOSFETs. Let's see. So, MOSFETs are super cool. You've seen them everywhere. You've heard about them everywhere. They're this magical device that runs all of our technology. I'm just going to erase this.
Maybe just do the Taylor series.
Yeah. What are MOSFETs? MOSFETs, you'll see they look something like this. They have three terminals, which is something new that you haven't really seen in this class before. They have something called the gate, and they have something called the source and the drain. So the actual physics of how this works, we won't go into, but basically electrons move from the source to the drain. Like source is where electrons come from, drain is where they go. So keep in mind that, you know, because of Benjamin Franklin and all that, we always flip things, so we talk about current as being positive. So we don't talk about electrons going from the source to the drain, we talk about our positive current going from the drain to the source. So that's how I always remember it. I remember source to drain, and then I flip it. So we'll draw the drain up here, and the source down here at ground. And how does this work? Well, basically, by applying a charge, we're able to kind of add, we change the physics of this layer. This is kind of drawn as a capacitor plate for good reason, because it kind of acts like that a little bit. And by changing the physics right behind the gate, we're able to turn on the device. So before, when there was no charge applied, the device, there's no current going through. And by applying a voltage at the gate, from the gate to the source, where the source is ground, we're able to then allow a current to flow through from the drain to the source. So we'll call that IDS. Okay, so what is our, you know, IV curve for this device? So I'm going to start by actually drawing the picture, and then we'll go and identify what that looks like in terms of our equations. And in particular, we're going to, so IDS, if we hook this up to a circuit, generally what you're going to care about is what is the current going from the drain to the source, and what is the voltage from the drain to the source. So if we really just think about the gate as our kind of control. So we'll talk about our IV curve as something relating IDS and VDS. ability to get many of these curves, and you get different curves depending on what the gate voltage is, what the voltage between the gate and the source is. So we'll look at that a little bit more closely. So there's one more thing. We get the device to turn on by applying a voltage between the gate and the source, but that's not the entire picture. These devices are characterized by a threshold voltage, so we'll call that VT. And really, the thing that turns on the device is not VGS, but it's VGS minus V threshold. So it's however much you've applied minus that kind of like minimum requirement. So I'm going to give that a variable name. I'm going to say VGS prime, or let's say maybe twiddle, is equal to, or defined as, VGS minus VT. Because at the end of the day, this difference is what we really care about. Equation for this look like. We have a piecewise system. So we can identify one region here, and it turns out that there are some regions where actually IDS is just going to be zero. And I'm going to make sure I copy this correctly, but then we'll see a way to derive this intuitively. So IDS. So there's going to be some region that we get zero current, and we get this this region if VGS is not enough to surpass VT. So we'll say this region is true if VDS bar is negative.
Jesus.
VGS. So VGS bar is our kind of simplified VGS, the thing we actually care about.
Right. The idea is that VT is your threshold voltage. It's the amount of VGS that you have to apply in order to turn it on. And so if VGS fails to even reach the threshold, then it's just going to be off. So Hannah's basically making VGS bar equal to VGS minus V threshold. So if that's negative, then we haven't reached the threshold to turn on. If it's positive, then we have met the threshold, and then we'll get current.
So I find it much easier to, in terms of, you know, something called VGS bar, because otherwise they look very complicated and I find it quite hard to analyze what's happening. So this region is known as cutoff. Basically, nothing happens. Okay? Then the next region we have is where we get something K over 2 VGS minus VT. Going to write that as VGS bar squared, and we get this when, let's see, so VGS bar is greater than zero, and all the other cases like make more sense, like the device is on, so we can see the curve. So I don't really need to bother writing the greater than zero part, but that should be implicit. And this is called saturation.
And one thing to notice is that saturation doesn't depend on VDS, right? It only depends on VGS bar / VGS. And that's why then over here on this curve, which is our current versus VDS, in saturation, it's not changing because it's no longer dependent on VDS.
between IVS and VDS, that means it can't depend on like another, it doesn't have, it only has a linear dependence on VDS. So if we're looking at all of these equations, we would see, okay, this one is zero. This is, we don't see the curve. This one is, we'll start with this one. This one depends on VDS. So if you're going to plot IVS versus VDS, well, it's not going to be linear because it depends on VDS. And so this is kind of our winner for this area. So our, oops, and I've, yeah. And that's the one confusing thing about this is the terminology. But this region, the straight line region, is our saturation region where IDS does not depend on VDS. So if we extend this line out, we'll find that it's actually just a constant at k over 2 times VGS bar squared. And this is really helpful to know. So when you start getting any kind of plot problem where they ask you to figure out quantities about your MOSFET, already if you were given a plot and they had some units and axes, you could figure out what VGS bar was or K was if you know the height of this line, because you know exactly the height of that line. The next region is this other region, and we see that this depends on VDS, and in particular we see it depends quadratically on VDS. So if we were to expand out this term, the first term in our expansion would be minus 1/2 VDS squared. So this is in fact a parabola. I'll label this one, one region 0, region 1, region 2. So we see that actually this is region 2 and this is region 1. And then region 0 is just a straight line. Okay, so as we're trying to fill out this plot, we might also ask, do we know that these curves meet? So I drew them as curves that meet, but do they meet? And if so, at what point? So we would ask ourselves, when are regions 1 and 2 equal? So if we do that, we'll actually find that they become equal at VDS equals VGS bar. And this gives you your equality, so the inequality. So this was what I was saying. I don't really try to write these out just from memory or anything. I'll always start with the plot, and then you can infer where this has to be true. So if we have this point where the two curves meet is going to be at a point called VGS bar. Now, the interesting thing is that we note that there's a relationship between the point at which they meet and the height. In particular, if VGS bar we call x, then the height is k over 2 x squared. And that's another parabola. So, in fact, if we drew the curves of the MOSFET for different values of VGS bar, and just to remind you, VGS bar depends on VGS and VT, so you could achieve different values of VGS bar by changing either the threshold of your MOSFET or by applying a different gate voltage. So those are two ways that this would change. You would actually trace out a parabola like this. So this would be all the points such that, f of x equals k over 2 x squared.
One other just very quick thing to note, like, this doesn't just pop out of, like, magic. Like, the fact that they meet where VDS equals VGS bar falls pretty directly from the formulas. If you plug in VGS bar, then the 1/2 comes from here, and you just get VGS bar squared. Like, it's not some magic formula. It's very straight from that.
And another thing to note is they don't just meet anywhere. They meet at the point, if you take the derivative of this function, you'll find that the point where they meet is actually the maximum of that parabola. So in particular, if we didn't look at this flat line curve and we just continued following this parabola, this would be the kind of inflection point, would be right here. So the curves meet, and they also meet continuously. Okay, so this is really helpful, knowing this picture and the variables that affect it. So in particular, the point where they meet is VGS bar, the height is k over 2 VGS bar squared, and they trace out a parabola. Is really helpful if you ever end up with questions about, for example, what happens when k changes, or what happens when VT changes. So kind of combining this with what Jacob was going through earlier with the load lines, you would do a similar sort of analysis. So we would say, if we drew some load line, say this is your load line. They could ask you, for example, how would you change, so if this is V in, and this point is, V in over R. So the same thing that we saw in our diode example, this would just be a MOSFET in series with a resistor. They could ask you, how would you change, or what is the value of Vin such that your device will operate in the, is this one saturation? Yeah, in the saturation region. Or what would be Vin such that you operated in the linear region? And again, it's really confusing that this is called the linear region even though it's not actually linear on this plot. I think it has a couple other names like triode and other things, so I'll just call it that because it doesn't look linear.
I think sometimes you might hear people call it ohmic too.
Ohmic, yeah. And if you had a question like that, you would realize that the point that defines the boundary between the saturation region and the triode ohmic region is on this curve. So to figure out the value of Vn such that you're operating on the boundary of those two points, of those two regions, you recognize that that's actually the intersection of the load line and this parabolic curve defining the boundary. So, you know, you would solve for a point like that. And generally, it's just helpful to know this in terms of, you could change parameters in this curve itself. So if you were going to keep the load line fixed, you could figure out how to move the curve. So in particular, we would move it to this location, and then you could figure out the new value of k or something like that. So there's a lot of things you can figure out from doing the combination of load line analysis and then also knowing what are these values and what is that curve.
Yeah, all Hannah did here to draw the second curve is just apply a different VGS. Right?
Yeah.
This is just for a different VGS bar.
So if we plot all of the different curves for a fixed k and VGS bar increasing, we would plot out parabolic regions that go until this curve, and then linear regions that go on. And as VGS increases, these curves would increase. And that makes sense, because intuitively, like, the more gate voltage you apply, the more you turn on your device, the more current you're going to get.
And in terms of the cutoff region that Hannah mentioned earlier, that's just like if VGS bar is 0, so if VGS is under VT, and then it's basically just like a flat line down here where you're getting no current.
Yeah, so always remember that there are these just flat lines where VGS bar is negative. Any questions? Yeah?
What happens if K changes?
So what do you think would happen if K changes? I'll pose this as a question. So if you leave VGS bar fixed and K changes, VGS is here, this parabola is defined by K. So if K increases, the parabola would become steeper, and for a given VGS bar, you would get higher currents. So I'm not going to draw that because it would be very messy, but you would imagine that if this curve shifts up, all of these points shift in, and all of these curves increase. So for a given VGS bar, the saturation, that constant saturation value, is going to be higher because it depends.
One other thing to note is that unlike with VGS, where apply, you could be asked, like, you know, if you were to replace this with a transistor whose K value was twice as the previous one or something like that, but it is good to sort of keep in mind the distinction between something like VGS or VDS, where you sort of have this device and you're applying it, versus some intrinsic property of the device itself.
Any questions? Okay. Okay, so we still have a little bit of time. I guess we could do like a vote or anything. I don't know what you guys prefer, but we could go over any topics from the beginning of the class, if you'd like that. Show of hands for like review a topic from the beginning of the class.
We can also just
yeah, we can also
into just like
Q&A.
Individual questions, and then I can both stay after. But if anybody has any questions, that it's more like, you know, do a full board explanation. Yeah.
I guess one thing that I'm kind of wondering about is the relationships between the linear and frequency domains, just the different domains and how they represent it graphically. That makes sense.
Mm-hmm.
The linear and frequency domains.
Or time domain and frequency domain.
Right. Time domain and frequency domain, what was the question about them, sorry?
The relationship between them and how they're represented graphically. So like what something like omega not would correspond to and believe or not, and so forth.
Yeah. Okay. Let's get okay, the race actually I'll just yeah, good question. There's a lot of similarities. Well, actually, there's a lot of properties that you've seen in both regimes. So you've seen quality factor when we talk about sinusoidal steady state. You've also seen quality factor when you talk about time domain. We went over that in depth in the second review session. But kind of the essence of it was you knew if you had in sinusoidal steady state, if you had some transfer function, V out over V in, and you knew this looked like, you know, I don't know, S over S squared minus 2 alpha S plus omega naught squared, you know that you can rewrite this as a differential equation in the time domain. So what you would get in the time domain would be V out double prime minus 2 alpha V out prime plus omega naught squared V out equals V in prime. So something like this, if you're not comfortable with like moving between these, come ask me afterwards. But basically there was this whole idea of we can identify the terms we see in our transfer function with the terms we see from the time domain. So when we define quality factor, the first time we defined it in the time domain. So we had said here that quality factor was defined as omega naught over 2 alpha. And when we were in and we know how we would graph something that that looked like that in the time domain. It would be some sort of like assuming it's underdamped, we would have some decay with an envelope e to the minus alpha t, and then we would have some oscillation. This decay is on both sides, and we would have some sort of something here where the frequency here. This frequency is actually omega d, which is equal to square root of omega naught squared minus alpha squared. What would something like this look like in the frequency domain? So in the frequency domain, then you would figure out what this looks like as s goes to 0, as s goes to infinity, and as s is somewhere in the middle. So you knew that with a transfer function like this, it would have a special, you know, quote, special behavior at the frequency omega. what you were getting was that the quality factor, which over here in the time domain, quality factor told you how many oscillations do you get, how much ringing do you get before you get this kind of damping decay. And here, quality factor is telling you, again, what is kind of the ability of this system to resonate to. So here, quality factor would be telling you about how narrow this peak was. So we had the formula, let's see, what was it, bandwidth. Bandwidth is, was it Q over omega naught?
That sounds correct to me.
Bandwidth. It's Q over omega naught. If anyone cares to correct this formula, please let me know. So here, as the quality factor increases, this filter would get kind of more peaky. But here, as we increase the quality factor, we would see this kind of stretch out, like we would see more ringing before we get a decay. Are there any, like, other, that person who asked the question, are there any, like, other details you want to see kind of side by side about frequency versus time?
I think that was the big one.
Okay. Anyone else? Yeah.
Sorry.
Oh, okay. Oh, sorry. Okay. Backwards.
Yeah. Because it's two alpha, so it's just reorganizing this one.
Oh, yeah, okay.
Yeah, over here.
Yeah, thank you. Bandwidth, so as you increase, right. As you increase the quality, it gets more peaky, so the bandwidth decreases. Yeah, thank you very much. Okay, were there other questions?
This is unrelated.
Okay.
Okay.
Are there any questions like related to this? You will be on the queue second. What was your question?
It just has to do with like graphing and the decibel or dB.
Okay.
Yeah.
So I guess it's kind of cool.
Okay. And then what was your question?
It was just about the MOSFET amplifier.
Okay, so we'll do that one after because this one's more related.
Yep.
Do you want to take this one?
Sure. Was it just like generally how to?
Yeah, like the 20 log stuff.
Yeah. Sure. So, like, literally what decibel means, it's kind of weird because it's, like, in decibels, like, its own unit, kind of. What decibel really means is minus 20 log base 10 of, like, whatever it is. So if you want to put something into decibels, you do, like, negative 20 log base 10 of it. And so oftentimes, it's a logarithmic scale. The 20 and the 10, you know, are basically just shifts of that or scalings of it. But in terms of sort of the idea behind it, it's just a logarithmic scale. And so oftentimes we'll be interested in looking at a transfer function's graph in what we say like decibels per decade or whatever. So what that really means is decibels is this, and then decade, like 10, corresponds to like, you know, like a 10x. Factor. So that's also like a logarithmic scale because again it's like multiplicative, that's exponential, and logarithmic is sort of the inverse of exponential. So oftentimes what you're going to end up doing is you're going to have a graph where you have, you know, I guess this is technically log omega, and then this is like, you know, 20 log base 10 of your magnitude of your transfer function, right? And so you'll get something maybe that looks like this, depends on your transfer function, whatever it is. But oftentimes because we're interested in sort of like how good it is at being high in the band where it should pass frequencies through but then attenuate frequencies it doesn't want, we're interested in sort of understanding like what is the roll-off there, which is basically what's the slope here. And so what that ends up turning into is you basically want to take this expression, you want to take the magnitude of your transfer function, do 20 log base 10 of it to get it into decibels, and then differentiate it with respect to log base 10 of omega.
And
because
like,
that's then your slope. No, go ahead.
And like the main reason why we bother taking things in log instead of the original is that a lot of things we care about, so if you remember when we were looking at the
there's a different derivative at different points, right? Like it's not just like some constant slope, otherwise it would just be a straight line. So if we were to do 20 log base 10 of the magnitude of our transfer function and then differentiate with respect to log omega, we're gonna get some function of omega, because depending on what frequency we're at, that slope will be different. And so oftentimes what we wanna do is we wanna look at what is that slope going to look like for different regions of omega. So that's often when we send omega to zero, send omega to infinity, and then maybe do something in the middle. So you can often then like evaluate what that slope should be at those different values, if that makes sense. The reason we often get like a negative 20 roll off or a negative 40 roll off, oftentimes it's like multiples of 20. It's basically because we have this 20 right here, 20 log base 10. So if we were to do something like, you know, 1 over omega or something like that, very, very simple example. If the magnitude of h of j omega were just 1 over omega, right? This would be like a very basic low-pass filter. Well, then if we plug it into there, then in decibels, in decibels, we get 20 log base 10 of 1 over omega, but because of like logarithmic exponential rules, this is equal to negative 20 log base 10 of omega, right? So then when we differentiate that with respect to log base 10 of omega, we just get negative 20. If this were like a 1 over omega squared, we would have gotten negative 40 and so on and so forth. So even though we're not going to actually get exactly the numbers negative 20, negative 40, oftentimes when we sort of like take the extreme limit as omega goes to infinity and a lot of the terms cancel out, we might get something like a negative 20 or a negative 40.
So like rule of thumb is that log log tells you kind of about the exponent of omega.
Does that make sense? Any to your question?
Yeah, so that's usually why like if you have an inductor and a capacitor doing the exposure stuff, you have a high roll off.
Right. Yeah, I mean, it has to do with the order of your system, right? So, like, with the first order system, where we're getting, like, 1 over omega, we'll get, like, a negative 20 roll-off. But in a second order system, we'll get negative 40 roll-off, potentially. So, like, the Salam-Key filter that we did, right, that had, like, the two separate capacitors, that was, like, a second order filter. So,
as Jacob had just derived, for a capacitor, which is 1 over j omega c, so if you set c equal to 1, you get this example. And you have this negative slope in log log space, log log. And for an inductor, instead of 1 over omega, you just have omega, so the exponent is just 1, so the slope is positive 20. So an inductor is the other way around. Low pass.
Do you mind if I erase this?
No.
I have it pulled up right there.
Oh, okay. Nice.
Yeah, so oftentimes it's useful to use a MOSFET in an amplifier configuration that's good at amplifying, and we'll actually see, based on all of the different regions stuff that Hannah was talking about earlier, why we use it as an amplifier the way that we do. So oftentimes you'll like have, you know, VCC, you know, your power, whatever, and then we have our load resistor RL. And then we have a MOSFET here, and we're applying our input voltage up to E. So if we have this circuit set up where we're measuring V out here, this is going to turn into an amplifier using the MOSFET. So basically what this is going to turn into is, we're going to have the analysis that Hannah did earlier, so whatever Vin is going to define your VGS, right? So VGS minus VT is just going to be Vin minus VT. So if we get something, you know, that looked, you know, like this for the, you know, IV curve just of the MOSFET, what we can do, this is kind of like similar to the diode example earlier where we have the IV curve just for the MOSFET, then we also have the load line because of the circuit we've placed it into. So just by like a simple case see that, you know, all the current through the resistor RL is the same as the current from the drain to the source in the MOSFET. So given that, we also see that, you know, Vout is VCC minus the drain current times RL, right? Whatever voltage is dropped across the load resistor from VCC gets us to Vout. So that gives us our load line that Hannah's drawing right now. And then our operating point is just going to be the intersection here. So it turns out that if we were to basically plot Vin versus Vout, right, because Vin is basically, like, this is our load line. This isn't going to change because the resistor is set and VCC is set. But what we do have control over is what Vin is, right? That's what we want to amplify. So depending on the value of Vin that we choose, it's going to make this curve appear in a different location. That's what Hannah was doing earlier with VGS bar shifting location. So given that, what we can do is we can sort of shift it around, and you can do the math for this, but you can basically derive an expression for Vout in terms of Vin. And it turns out that if you graph that relationship, you're going to get something like this, where up here, it's just that, sorry. Up here, it's just at VCC itself. Now, when would Vout be equal to VCC? Well, Vout is equal to VCC if no current, if no voltage drops across the resistor RL. No voltage drops across the resistor RL when no current goes through it. No current goes through it when no current goes through the MOSFET. No current goes through the MOSFET when we're in the cutoff region. So this up here, like this region, is the cutoff region. So that's when Vn is very small and it hasn't yet reached the threshold. We're in the cutoff region. We just get VCC as our output. It's not a very good amplifier yet because we can change Vn to anything we want less than the threshold, and we're just getting a constant output voltage. Then in here, this is the saturation region. Once Vin has exceeded the threshold, we're in the saturation region. Then if we make Vin too big, such that like VGS bar exceeds VDS, then this is our triode region. So this curve basically comes directly from here. If we were to draw other curves, basically, like, if we were to draw other curves for, like, these are for different possible values of Vn, basically seeing where the load line intersects those different lines, gives us this curve, right? We've basically taken these points where the load line is hitting the transistor equations for different values of Vn, and we basically just plotted all of that on here. So as you'll notice, the time when we're getting like the largest amplification is in the saturation region, right? Because that's when the slope is highest. So the idea is that if we're operating in some little window of Vn, right, if we have some thing that's like oscillating for Vn back and forth in that little window, well, that hits this line in very different locations because the slope is pretty steep. So that's going to lead to a much larger output. And that's how we get our amplifier. And you can actually analyze exactly how this works, basically like we did before, where you, if you want to, you can basically find your bias point, and then you can linearize this by figuring out, like, you know, what is the tangent line slope here. And then you can get your small signal model for this amplifier and get your total solution. And I do recommend strongly reading back through the most recent recitation notes. I think it was recitation 13 or something. Whichever one was just on Wednesday, the Farmhouse Day.
And like, I definitely, when I saw this at first, I was like very confused how like iteration is just making sure that you remember the load line is fixed, and as these curves increase, the point at which it's going to intersect this line is going to increase. So as Vn increases, this curve is going to be really high up here, so the intersection point is going to be very high over here, which corresponds to V0 being very low. So big Vn, low Vout. And as we move these down, we see that as Vn is smaller, then the intersection point is going to be bigger because these curves are going to move farther out along the intersection of this line. So that kind of makes... Okay.
Yeah, just one other thing to note, just because there are so many lines in this graph,
yeah,
just to be clear on which is which, all of these guys are just the relationship between IDS and VDS for our transistor for different values of Vn. This parabola is the one that Hannah drew earlier, which is basically like the region distinction between triode versus saturation. And then this straight line is the load line that has to do with our current circuit that we're looking at.
And like, I always find it helpful to draw this line because then I know how to draw these curves as it gets bigger. Like, I know where this point of flatness
I didn't draw it perfectly, but it should become flat when it hits this line. This one. Did that answer your question about MOSFET amplifiers? Okay, awesome.
Other questions? We can also switch into just doing one-on-one questions unless people have more, like, full board things. Okay. All
right.
Good luck on the exam.
Yeah, good
congratulations,
luck, guys.
You're almost done with 6002.
And yes, please come up to us after.